really wonderful to have you here with us. Welcome to the Schola Cantorum, who are going to be lifting our praise of Almighty God this morning as they assist us in our song. It's really wonderful to have them with us. And thank you, a big thank you to Highland and Estate Vineyard, who sponsor this wonderful music in our church. It's really wonderful to have that provision. Thank you, Highland. Welcome to those who are joining us on Facebook Live at home. Really good to have you with us, and big thanks to Mackenzie for live streaming our service this morning. You should hopefully have an order of service which has a cross on the front of it and a copy of the weekly news sheet. The order of service has the liturgy for this morning, and the weekly news sheet has the hymns and readings, as well as bits of news, which I'm going to tell you about now. Firstly, just to say that our giving month of October is going really well. We're so pleased with how well it's going. We had a bumper number of people giving last week, and we're delighted to say that some very generous benefactors have agreed to match donations received before the end of October up to the sum of £25,000. So now is the time to give to our Annex project if you're planning to do so, and you will double your donation by giving in the month of October. So please do think about giving to the Annex project if you haven't done so already. We're really looking forward to moving forward with the Annex project. We've got a big bid coming up for a fund called Your Fund Surrey, which we hope will provide a significant grant, which may very well make the Annex a reality sooner rather than later. So please do pray for our bid to Your Fund Surrey, there'll be things in the news sheet about that very soon. YOP, our youth group, is relaunching this afternoon, at 4 p.m. in the church. Please do let people know who you think might like to come along to YOP. That's at 4 o'clock in the church here in West Clandon. We've got a couple of fundraising events coming up. Firstly, the bridge afternoon, that's on the 21st of November. Put that in your diary if you're a bridge player. That's in aid of the Annex. Also in aid of the Annex in January, do put it in your diary because I know how quickly the year can fill up. We've got a quiz night, which Ingrid is running. So bridge afternoon run by Petria and Pam. If you want to find out more about that, Petria and Pam are in this quadrant of the church. They'll let you know who they are. If you don't know who they are already, you surely do. And Ingrid is just here, who will tell you about the quiz night. So please do put those events in your diary. It'd be wonderful to welcome you to those events. There are notes about our music today in the weekly news sheet, so please do have a look at those. That will give you an idea of what it is that we're going to be hearing from the Schola Cantorum and from Sebastian. I'm going to leave you with Sebastian for a little while longer, unless I've forgotten anything. Oh, there are refreshments after the service. Please do stay behind for refreshments, and huge thanks to Mia for providing those. I think that's it. I'm going to leave you with Sebastian for a little while longer, and then he'll strike up with our first hymn in a moment, for which we stand, Hills of the North Rejoice.
hills of the north rejoice, echoing songs arise. Hail with united voice him who made earth and skies. He comes in righteousness and love, he brings salvation from above. Isles of the southern seas, his promise true. Lands of the east, arise, he is your brightest morn. Greet him with joyous eyes, praise shall his path adorn. The God whom ye have longed to know, in Christ draws near and calls you now. Shores of the utmost west, lands of the setting sun, welcome the heavenly guest in whom the dawn has come. He brings an ever-ending light who triumph o'er our darkest night. Shout as you journey on, songs be in every mouth. Lo, from the north they come, from east and west and south. In Jesus all find their rest, in him the sons of earth are blessed. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. As we prepare our hearts to celebrate the mysteries of God's love for us revealed in Jesus Christ, we keep a moment of quiet as we recall our sins and ask for God's forgiveness. We sit or kneel to pray. Almighty God, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. We We stand as we praise God in the words of the Gloria in Excelsis. Let us pray. Blessed God, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, help us so to hear them, to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that through patience and the comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and forever hold fast the hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We sit for our first scripture reading.
Former priests were many in number, because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But he holds his priesthood permanently, because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to, for all time, to save those who approach God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting that we should have had such a high priest, holy, blameless, undefiled, separate from sinners and exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he has no need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for those of the people. This he did once for all when he offered himself. The law appoints as high priests those who are subject to weakness. The word of the oath, which came later than the law,
Thanks be to God. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. And magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together.
O taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
This poor soul cried and was heard by the Lord and was saved from every trouble. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him.
O taste and see that the Lord is good. Stand as we hear the gospel. The Lord be with you. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus and his disciples came to Jericho. As he and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he's calling you." So, throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. When the ten heard this, they began and followed him on the way. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Bartimaeus was a blind, homeless beggar. He was the kind of unfortunate soul that if you probably met him on the high street in Guildford, you might very well do your best to avoid. And yet, in Mark's gospel, far from being portrayed as an unfortunate soul, in many ways, Bartimaeus is portrayed as the ideal disciple of Jesus Christ, a model for all subsequent followers of Jesus. There is much more to this miracle story than simply a story which shows us that Jesus wields the power of God although of course it is a story that teaches us that too. There are in fact two stories about the blind being healed in Mark's gospel. The first is in Mark chapter 9. Jesus heals a blind man by rubbing saliva into his eyes, allowing him to see but not clearly. The man can see, but he says, these objects, they look like trees walking around. He was looking at people. Then Jesus placed his hands on the blind man's eyes and for a second time, after which the blind man's sight was fully restored. Perhaps there's something in this about the way in which all of us gain spiritual sight, with the eyes of our faith being opened bit by bit, as it were, as we come to know God. First we see what it looks like trees moving about, and then as we grow, we come to know God, we see more clearly. The second healing of a blind person that we've just heard in Mark chapter 10 is the bracket, if you like, to a section of teaching in Mark's gospel about discipleship. Mark tells two stories sandwiched between these two healing stories about people who struggled to see spiritually, people who struggled to believe and follow Jesus Christ. And we've thought about them over the last couple of weeks, but maybe a recap here might be helpful. The first story was of a very devout, rich young man who came to Jesus asking if he could inherit eternal life. Jesus advised him to keep God's commandments, and the rich man replied that he had done this with great vigor from his youth. Jesus, looking at him with love, then said that he lacked one thing: to sell everything he owned, to give it to the poor, and to follow him. And the man walked away sad because he couldn't see. He couldn't see that closeness to God through following Jesus Christ was worth more than all of the riches in the world. One person who couldn't see. Compare this with Bartimaeus, a man who had no value and nothing of value. He was landless, he was disabled, he had only his raggedy cloak and a belief that Jesus could help him, a belief that he wouldn't give up on, even when people told him to stop bothering Jesus. And then finally, Jesus' call on his life came. What did Bartimaeus do? Gather up his cloak and carry it with him to meet Jesus, his one outer garment? No, Mark's gospel tells us. Throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Now that might seem a foolish thing to do if you're a beggar. This was probably the only outer garment that this poor man owned, the one thing he had to fight off the cold of the night. It might also have been the object that he would spread out on the ground in front of him to gather the few coins and scraps of food that the charitable rich threw down for him. As a blind man, once he'd cast that cloak aside, what hope was there that he would ever find it again? But Bartimaeus believed. He believed that this call from Jesus mattered more than anything. He believed that Jesus had the power to heal him, and he probably felt that he would soon no longer have any need for a beggar's cloak because Jesus had called him. He cast aside even the little that he had to follow the Lord. This, I think Mark's gospel is trying to say to us, is the path of a true believer, the path which the rich man couldn't see. The second story, I suppose you might say, of failed discipleship, is the story that we heard last week, which Helen preached on, the story of two of Jesus' disciples, James and John. They approached the Lord Jesus and said, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask." That's quite a request. Takes a bit of pluck, but there we have it. "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask." "What do you want me to do for you?" came the reply. Note that that is exactly the same thing that Jesus said to Bartimaeus. What do you want me to do for you? James and John reply, grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in glory. They wanted power and they wanted influence because of their relationship with Jesus. And by that request, they show that they too had failed to see what Jesus was really doing in the world. He wasn't bringing in a kingdom which was there to give power and influence and wealth to those who followed him. He was treading the way of the cross. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus says to the blind man. And the man answers, my teacher, let me see again. And asking for his physical sight, he receives that and much more. He received spiritual sight, the sight which the disciples still clearly lacked. He was sent on his way healed. But, note, having been dismissed by Jesus, Bartimaeus made the decision not to listen. He didn't go his way. He decided to become a disciple. Immediately that he regained his sight, he followed Jesus on the way, a phrase which itself suggests that Mark is talking about more than just a miracle, because in Mark's gospel, the way always means the way to the cross. Bartimaeus, a healed man, a man with sight, doesn't go his way simply reveling in his new sight. He follows Jesus. He commits himself to being a disciple of Jesus on the way of the cross, the one thing which James and John were not prepared for. Bartimaeus saw what the other disciples couldn't see. He saw that in the Lord Jesus Christ, God has come to us to be our friend, not to be served, but to serve and to stand with us, bringing us healing and wholeness and sight. Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the model disciple, our teacher on the difficult, joyful journey of following Jesus Christ. He shows us what a true Christian looks like, a person of humility, a person of courage and boldness, who throws themselves on the mercy of Jesus Christ, a person who's willing to take risks, a person who will follow Christ wherever it may lead, willing to cast away anything that would keep him from following. Let us then, in our day, hear the Lord Jesus' voice asking us the same question as he asked James, John, and Bartimaeus. What do you want me to do for you? To give us wealth or power, or to grant that we might see and follow him on the way of the cross? As we are able, we stand to declare our faith in Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We sit or kneel now for our prayers of intercession. Let us pray.
Accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
As we are able, we stand as we share Christ's peace with each other. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God." We meet in Christ's name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Okay. That's okay, don't worry. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Mary. Richard, peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Alison, peace be with you. Peace be with you, Louise. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Richard. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Peace be with us. Peace be with Petra. Peace be with you, Angie. Les. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Angie. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Robin, peace be with you.
As we stand, we sing our offertory hymn, which might not have familiar words to you, but will, I'm sure, have a familiar tune. We sing, "We Cannot Measure How You Heal." And during the singing of this hymn, we take up a collection for the work of God's church. Thought I'd come and say, peace be with you. Peace be with you. You can come in whenever you want. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Whenever you want to, okay, but come in for communion.
How you heal or answer every sufferer's prayer, yet we believe your grace responds where faith and doubt unite to care. Your hands the blooded
to you, the God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine which we have in the infusion of our spiritual. Mighty God, be pleased to receive this offering to the praise and glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord God of power and might, receive the gifts we offer and let our service give you glory. We pray that you would grant this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. From sunrise to sunset, this day is holy, for Christ has risen from the tomb and has scattered the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people. unfolds for us your word and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so with choirs of angels and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and join their unending song of praise. Sit or kneel. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way after supper he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, St. Peter, St. Paul, St. Thomas of Canterbury, the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Formed by divine teaching and at our Saviour's command, with boldness we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. All are welcome to receive God's gifts from this altar. We receive Holy Communion standing at the chancel step. If you would like to receive consecrated bread intincted or dipped into consecrated wine, please stand in front of the chalice to my left. If you would like to either just receive the consecrated bread or drink from a chalice, please stand directly in front of me. And if you'd like to drink from a chalice, move to the chalice on my right. Lord, bring to perfection within us the communion we share in this sacrament. May our celebration change our lives. We ask this in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Thank you again for coming to the Eucharist here at the Church of St. Peter and St. Paul this morning. It's been wonderful to welcome you. Please do stay behind after the service for some refreshments, which are served from the back of the church. I think in this last bit of notices, we can show our appreciation to the Schola for leading us in our worship this morning. Thank you so much for lifting our worship. And thank you to Sebastian, too, for all that you do musically. Yes. Now, I wonder whether Ludovic and Bibi, we've had Sunday Club Light today, and Ludovic and Bibi have been doing some things. Have you made some things in the tower room together? Do you want to bring them out so that we can have a look? Because they've been looking at, I think, probably the same gospel reading that we've been looking at. And they've got something special to show us. Now, Ludo or Bibi, can you remember the name of the man who was blind in our story? Bartimaeus. And if you've got problems with your eyes today, you wouldn't really do this. Doctors wouldn't do this now. But what did Jesus do? In fact, he didn't do it with Bartimaeus, but he did it with another person. You've got something on this person's hands. What did he... There's mud, but Jesus with Bartimaeus told him that your sight you've received your sight, your faith has made you well. But with another healing story, which we also thought about this morning, Jesus put mud on the man's eyes. Would you do that to make someone's eyes better? No? Anyone here? Anyone worked in hospitals with people's eyes before? No? No doctors have ever smeared mud in your hands? BB? No? No. But if you open this up, Bartimaeus can't see, and then he can see because he comes to Jesus and Jesus makes his eyes better. But he not only can see Jesus and other people physically,